Well, this is another one of those 4K releases that many people have asked me to take a look at, but if my experience is anything to go by, Superman 2 is selling very well on 4K disc because I've been unable to get a copy until now. Eventually, I got this off the HMV website. It had been out of stock for ages. It finally came back into stock for about a day. I managed to nab a copy and here it is, and I am very impressed with what I've seen with two versions, two almost completely different versions of Superman 2, and I think it's one of the best sequels that was ever made. Richard Donner was directing both Superman the movie and Superman 2 concurrently, so I don't really know how anyone ever managed to separate the budgets for both, but the estimated budget of Superman 2 is listed as $54 million, and it took, at the worldwide box office, $190 million. The original release version of the film has a running time of 2 hours and 7 minutes. It has an aspect ratio of approximately 2.40 to 1, and it comes this time with Dolby Atmos sound. However, there is original theatrical sound on this disc, and on my system, THX 5.1, that sounded far, far better than the Dolby Atmos. So I expect it sounds better on a lot of high-end Dolby Atmos systems, or even Dolby Atmos in general. But if you haven't got one of those, or you value getting the best out of your system, give both a try before you sit down to watch this one, because you may be surprised at the original Dolby Stereo theatrical sound. Now, I didn't see it in 70mm, but there were 70mm blow-up prints of Superman 2. I only saw it at my local cinema back in the day in 35mm, and I was very, very impressed with it. At the time, I actually thought it was better than Superman the movie, but now I'm older, hopefully a little bit wiser, I can now see that Superman the movie is the superior film. Not everyone will agree with me on that, but other opinions are available. Anyway, to get into Superman 2 on 4K disc, it really is a surprising package. I didn't know anything about this release, I just bought it blind. I like to go into films having not seen them, or not having seen them in a long time, or knowing anything about them. And of course, I had seen Superman 2 many times. I never got the Super 8 release, but it had a 2x600 foot Super 8 release, which by all accounts was excellent. I think I saw an extract from it, the famous battle in Metropolis, and my recollection is that it looked very good, but not one of the best Super 8 releases of all time. But I would still like a copy. But there are four discs in here. You've got the original version of the film on one 4K disc. Then you've got that on the Blu-ray, which the quality of the Blu-ray at the time probably would have been excellent. But you compare that to the 4K and you think, my God, how did we put up with that? Then you've got the Donner Cut on 4K. And isn't it amazing that this has been gone through by Warner Brothers and released in 4K. I know it had already been done, I think it was 2005, 2006, they did the work after an internet campaign to get the Donner Cut assembled and out, because it was issued on DVD and Blu-ray previously. But to put that out on 4K, I just think that's amazing. And I do think the grading between the Donner Cut and the original cut, to my eyes, the Donner Cut has a more sort of realistic, darker look, but I might be wrong, I might be imagining it. I've gone backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards, and I'm struggling to see the difference. But my first impression when I watched the Donner Cut, which I watched half of it as is, and then for half of it I put the commentary on, but I thought this actually looked slightly more realistic than the original cut. And maybe that goes with Donner's verisimilitude, which I believe is Latin for reality, and that was what he wanted to do with Superman, was to ground it in reality so it would be more believable. Not campy, not too campy anyway. There was a bit of comedy in the first one, and he was including a bit in the second, but in the main he wanted Superman taken seriously. Now, I thought the sound on the Dolby Stereo tracks was excellent. Oh, beautiful surround in here, and it was totally fitting for the film. It really did make me feel like I was back in 1980 watching the film as it should be seen. However, the image quality, now the image quality of this 4K is too good. It sounds a bit ridiculous to say that, but when I saw it at the cinema, the screen was about 40 feet wide at my local. It was a general release print, so it hadn't been struck from the original camera negative. And how this is done, the original camera negative was used for the 70mm blow-ups and any master prints for 35mm for premiere houses that presumably weren't able to screen 70mm. So the original camera negative is protected by, from once that is assembled, going to an interpositive. Film always goes from negative, positive, negative, positive. So it went from an interpositive, and that interpositive is used to work out all the colour grading, the density grading, the whole shebang. And from that, a new negative is created called the internegative. And it is that internegative that is then used to create the general release prints. And so what I saw was a general release print. And if anything happens to that internegative, then a new negative is created from the interpositive. All seems a bit logical when you think about it, so I hope I've got that entirely right. I'm sure someone will correct me down below in the comments if I haven't. But that's my understanding of it, always has been. And so I saw a print from the internegative. Now that does result in a bit of image degradation because we're fourth generation, not second generation, as this 4K disc. But on this, it is so sharp, and on a small screen, because I'm only projecting at the moment about 9 feet, 2 inches wide, you can see everything, absolutely everything. And of course, this was 1977 to 1980, they were working on this film. There's a lot of optical effects, a lot of blue screen, green screen, and it is sometimes obvious where that has been done because we're not watching it on a huge screen with the necessary image degradation that the makers were expecting at that time. So I think you've got to expect that you are going to spot some of the special effects in this, but how good are they? Some of them are just so convincing, you'll believe a man can fly. And that was the original intention of Superman the movie. And that was the main delay in making Superman the movie. Richard Donner really did want to make people believe that a man was flying. It took a while to work it out, and he had to rely on special effects technicians, and quite a few people were giving it a go until after about 6 weeks of experimentation, he was called in to say, look at this. And that original shot of Christopher Reeve flying through the studio was shown, and yes, you could believe a man could fly. So they were behind the schedule, going over budget, and I know we're talking 1978 to 1980, so not the hundreds of millions that you get today, but at the time, this was a massive investment, a big risk. And Pierre Spengler, the producer, was under pressure, I suppose, from the Salkinds as well, who were funding it or getting the money for it. And so Richard Donner came under increasing pressure. But as they got behind, they had to drop what they were doing to get them both done at the same time. And so Superman 2 fell by the wayside a bit to the end, and they concentrated on getting Superman the movie into the cinemas. And that they did, but they struggled with the ending of Superman the movie, and so they used the ending from Superman 2, where Superman turns back time by turning the Earth backwards in order to save Lois Lane. But that isn't how it was originally conceived, and it was going to end with Superman putting the nuclear bombs out into space. You follow the second bomb, it explodes, and the three villains from Krypton are then released and they're free. And of course, that's when Superman will return in Superman 2 came up. So if you watch the Donner cut and you think, like Keith did, Euphoria Pictures, he and I had one of our short conversations on the phone a few evenings ago, and we were discussing the ending. I hadn't seen it at that time. And I said, well, this is ridiculous. What do they use the same ending for? That's why they did it. And fortunately, it's all explained in the extras on the Blu-ray for the Donner cut on here. So I'm really impressed with it. I love the image quality, despite it rather making a bit of a mockery of some of the effects. But I think I'm surprised most by how much I enjoyed the Donner cut, which is a bit of a lash up because they'd only filmed about 70-80% of it. And so they had to use a few alternate scenes, alternate angles that they maybe wouldn't have done. But it's worth watching. I would have kept Richard Lester's ending of Clark Kent kissing Lois Lane to make her forget, but they didn't. They used the same ending from Superman 1. That is the only thing I think I'd have done differently to Richard Donner, but I do accept that this must have caused him great frustration and angst, and he was fired on making something he really loved doing. And years later, he was brought back to look at it, and he just couldn't do it. And it took him a while, I think, to get back into it. But he listened to the commentary, and by the time he was doing the commentary, I think he loved what he was doing again. So great to actually see the Donner cut of Superman 2. And I do think, even though I love Superman 2 as it was, I would have preferred it if he would have been able to finish that film. So anyway, that's enough of me waffling on about how good I think this, well, both versions of the film are. I probably wouldn't have known so much about Superman and Superman 2 if I didn't subscribe to Cinema Retro. This is the latest edition of the magazine. Only 3 times a year this comes out, so it is rather special when it does come through the door. I do recommend it to anyone. They had a great sequence on Superman a few years ago that I did show in my review of Superman the movie. And I do recommend Cinema Retro to anyone who loves the movies. Just a shame, really, with the Superman films that when they were doing the special effects, they didn't use VistaVision or 65mm, because then they would have been so much better disguised. But I suppose it was budgetary constraints, or maybe here in Britain, because this was all filmed at Pinewood. It's got to be the best studio in the world, and it's certainly going to be the biggest soon, as Cinema Retro tells us. They've got a major expansion coming, and that will make it the biggest movie studio in the world. But it appears that no one thought or had the money to use VistaVision or 65mm for the effects, and it's such a shame, because there would have been so much more seamless today. So that would be my only criticism. The colour, I think, is beautiful. The density is wonderful. It is really good 35mm quality, and Superman 2 looks markedly superior to Superman the movie. So I can't really explain to you why that is, but I'm far more impressed with Superman 2 on 4K than Superman the movie, and I was rather impressed with Superman the movie. So I don't think anyone's going to be disappointed if you do get a copy of this. And it is tempting now to take a look at Superman 3. I'll see how I feel. But I do now prefer Richard Donner's more grounded in reality, verisimilitude approach. And maybe Richard Lester, who was brought in to act as go-between between Donner and producer Spengler because the relationship was breaking down. He did take over some of the shooting towards the end on Superman the movie. And indeed, when he did Superman 2, he had to reshoot lots of it. So his name would be on there as director. So it was a bit of a mishmash putting Superman 2 together, and it all makes it so much more interesting now that we know the full story of what really went on. So just don't expect this to look entirely perfect all the way through. If you're into superhero films, I think you'll be more than pleased with this one. Now, I think my next review is going to be a second sight by the name of The Changeling, which is actually a Severin transfer. Severin Films in America have also got a very high reputation, just like Second Sight. But I've had the preview disc of The Changeling, and I now have the full pack on its way, because this is a Blu-ray, and I want to have a look at that 4K. It's always been a grainy film, very coarse film grain on The Changeling. So don't expect anything too perfect again, but that grainy look is a deliberate approach to give a haunted house story, a ghost story, a particular look to draw you in and make it all feel creepy. So I'm very much looking forward to seeing how that looks on 4K compared to that Blu-ray. So that one's probably coming next. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a like and perhaps consider subscribing, so I'll be encouraged to carry on creating content like this. Until the next video, which will hopefully be Second Sight Films The Changeling. What a creepy film that is. Bye bye for now.